you have your Bibles, Jeremiah 39, we're studying chapter by chapter, verse by verse, book by book, through the Old Testament on Wednesday nights. Welcome again to those watching online and you guys here in the house. We're going to try maybe go through three chapters tonight. I don't want to scare you. We'll end on time or maybe even early. It's a story that flows, so I'm going to pretty much read the story and comment as we go along to try to clarify what's happening. But it's interesting, the parallels between the text and what's happening right now in the Ukraine. It's about some of the stuff's about the horrors of war and all the deceit and the lying and all the stuff that goes on. It's pretty interesting. But Lord, we pray that you'd speak to us from Jeremiah 39, 40, 41, that you would just use these things somehow to build our lives up for your glory, God. We commit these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you haven't been with us as we're studying Jeremiah, this is a time period in the history of these people, the descendants of Abraham that God has raised up. And through them, the plan is he's going to bring his light and salvation to the entire world. Okay, but what we're finding is that these people that God raised up, the chosen people, they need the very salvation that God's going to bring through them as much as we do. We, the ones to whom the salvation comes, they need God just like anybody else. And today, you and I as the church, we are the people now through whom God is seeking to reach the world. We need the salvation that we preach. So we don't preach down to any man. We don't preach down to any woman. We share the gospel, person to person. I need Jesus. I need the Jesus I preach. I need the grace of God that I preach. But here, Jeremiah's been warning Judah. Judah's the tribe. The capital of Judah is Jerusalem, and Judah is the tribe from which Christ will come. Jesus, the Messiah, will come. And so Jeremiah has been prophesying to Judah. You see, they turned from God to worthless idols. They turned from God who is love, the Bible tells us in 1 John. They turned from him, and so they had ceased from loving each other. They ceased from being a witness of God to the world. They turned to worthless idols that they made with their hands, and it's no wonder that they were treating each other as worthless. We become like the God we worship, however wretched, however false. And so God's call to us is to look unto him. To fix our eyes upon him, on Jesus, to draw our life from him, and then that love can flow through us and we can be the light and the witness he wants us to be in the world. And so through Jeremiah, God is saying to them, you're going to get spanked real bad, okay? Because there hasn't been a turning back. And at this point in the history, it's a foregone conclusion. They're going to be carried away captive into Babylon. 70-year spanking by God, you know. And then God's going to bring them back, and he's going to fulfill everything that he promised that he would do in them and through them for the world. That's kind of the big context. But when we come here tonight, we come to the moment when Jerusalem is penetrated by the Babylonians, this moment that Jeremiah has been warning of. And there will be this final deportation of the people into Babylon. And it says in the ninth year of Zedekiah, he's the last king of Judah before this final fall of Jerusalem. In the ninth year of King Zedekiah of Judah, in the 10th month, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, and all of his army came against Jerusalem and besieged it, okay? So here we're given the time reference of when the siege was set. This is a war tactic where you surround a city and then you choke it out until the people are so weakened that you can just walk in and take over. Then in the 11th year, so in the 9th year, the siege starts. In the 11th year, in the fourth month, the 9th day of the month, the city was penetrated. Okay? So they weakened Jerusalem, choking it off with the siege for 18 months, if you do the math. And then they invade the city. Now, the book of Lamentations describes vividly some of the agonies that they were experiencing during the siege. But here, just like Jeremiah said, the city will fall. The city will fall. And so Jeremiah here is proven right, which he takes no delight in. And the false prophets are proven wrong. And then all the princes of the king of Babylon came in into the city of Jerusalem and sat in the middle gate. And then it names all these guys. I'm not going to butcher their names, these Babylonian names. And they all came in with the rest of the princes of the king of Babylon. So they come and they sit in the middle gate. Notice there, this is where in these walled cities of that day in the ancient world, the city gates were where the elders of the city, it's where the seat of power was, where the courts would convene and hear cases. And so for these invaders here to sit in the gate of the city here, it's a show of dominance and authority. It's saying to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, this city is ours now. You know, in a modern day setting, it would be like an enemy conquering Washington, D.C., and then going in and sitting in the Oval Office. And so it was when Zedekiah, the king of Judah, and all the men of war saw them, the city's been penetrated now, they're sitting in the gates, that they fled. They fled, they took off, which is what we thought the president of Ukraine would do, but he didn't. But they took off, they went out of the city by night by the way of the king's garden and by the gate between the two walls, and he went out by the way of the plain. And so here's Zedekiah, who has refused to listen to Jeremiah. Jeremiah's message was submit. God is going to use Babylon to spank you. If you submit, you'll live, your family will be safe, and the city will not be destroyed. He would not listen to the prophet of God, and now he deserts the very people, all the very people that were with him, that he himself had doomed by his disobedience. Ezekiel 12:12, the prophet Ezekiel remarkably prophesied that Zedekiah would indeed do what he's doing here, that he would flee, that he would run for his life. But the Chaldean army, okay, the Babylonians, they pursued them. They pursued Zedekiah and his men that were on the run, overtook Zedekiah in the plains of Jericho, okay? And they captured him. And they brought him up to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, to Riblah, which is an ancient Syrian town on the river Orontes, in the land of Hamath, where they pronounced judgment upon him. Now, Jeremiah had prophesied, if you remember back in chapter 32 and 34, that Zedekiah would indeed come face to face with the king of Babylon. And so here those prophecies are fulfilled. And then the king of Babylon killed the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes there in Riblah. And the king of Babylon also killed the nobles of Judah. So they kill all of his men, they kill his sons, they leave him alive. They leave him alive here. But notice, moreover, he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with bronze fetters to carry him off to Babylon. And so here is a horror of war. The last thing he saw was his sons being put to death, and then they blinded him. The last thing that was burned into his mind's eye was the death of his own sons. And now he's blinded with that image stuck in his brain. Pretty crazy. This fulfilled the mysterious word that God gave Ezekiel regarding Zedekiah shortly before the fall of Jerusalem. You can check it out in Ezekiel 12:13. Because Ezekiel said, God said through Ezekiel, I will bring him, Zedekiah, to Babylon, to the land of the Chaldeans. He shall not see it, though he will die there. I'm going to bring him there, but he won't see it, and he'll die there. And people would look at that and go, how can you bring him there and he not see it? Well, they blinded him. And so he indeed, like Ezekiel had prophesied, was taken there, but he never saw it, and he ended up dying there in Babylon. And the Chaldeans burned the king's house and the houses of the people with fire and broke down the walls of Jerusalem. Now, the fall of Jerusalem is so important in Scripture that the Scripture records it in four different places. Well, here, also in Jeremiah 52 that we'll get to in a few, maybe a couple months. And then in 2 Kings 25 and finally in 2 Chronicles 36, he's seeing God's plan to bring his light and salvation to the world. There's a chosen land, which is the land of Israel. There's a chosen city, which is the city of Jerusalem. And there's a chosen people, these descendants of Abraham, the Jewish people. And so the fall of Jerusalem is a massive marker in world history. Okay? And so it's here is the breaking down of the walls of Jerusalem right there. And then Nebuzaradan. Okay, this is not Nebuchadnezzar. This is Nebuzaradan. Okay? Nebuzaradan. He's the captain of the guard. He's Nebuchadnezzar's captain, the captain of his guard. So Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, carried away captive to Babylon the remnant of the people who remained in the city, and those who defected to him with the rest of the people, who remained. And so there's the final deportation of these people, the people of Judah. But Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, left in the land of Judah. He left there the poor people who had nothing, and he gave them vineyards and fields at the same time. So everybody except the very poorest of the people that had nothing, everybody else was taken away. And what this is they're going to force these people that remain to harvest the land, and then they're going to tax them and take everything from them. They'll have enough for their sustenance, but all of the produce from all of their labors will be tribute to Babylon. This is how it worked in the ancient world. All of this was a fulfillment of the word of the Lord. All of this that's happening here vindicates Jeremiah, God's prophet. And yet Jeremiah took zero pleasure in all the pain that Judah is bringing upon herself here by ignoring God. You know, just to reiterate what we've seen, the summary of what we've seen so far in the book of Jeremiah, that Jeremiah has told Judah. He said disaster would come from the north. He said that God would allow a strange and foreign nation to attack. That God said Jerusalem would be surrounded and besieged. And that there would be a famine in the land. God, through Jeremiah, had warned that the whole land would be laid waste. God said that the nations and kingdoms would be torn down. God said that that death would enter the city of Jerusalem. He said that the enemy kings would sit in the gates, as we see here in this chapter, and that the city would be burned and that the people would be taken into exile. So this is all a fulfillment. Jeremiah is vindicated, but takes no pleasure at all. His heart, his love for the people was that they would have repented. Now Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, verse 11, gave charge concerning Jeremiah to Nebuzaradan, the captain of his guard, saying, take Jeremiah and look after him, do him no harm, but do to him just as he says to you. Do whatever Jeremiah wants, okay? And so when it all comes down, Jeremiah has been imprisoned and beaten and thrown into a cistern and left to die, and he's been emaciated and starved and, you know, treated so horribly by his own people because they didn't like the prophecies, even though they were for the people's well-being. And here, the king of Babylon is saying, look after this guy. Do for him whatever he wants. God is caring for his servant, is what this is. He's keeping him safe. He's giving him favor. And so Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, sent Nebushashban. I dare you to name your first, if you're a young couple here, to name your first two boys, Nebuzaradan and Nebushashban. Okay. And then this other guy and this other guy and all the kings of Babylon's chief officers. Verse 14, then they came and they sent someone to take Jeremiah from the court of the prison and committed him. Notice here, Gedaliah, he's a guy that we're going to be looking at here, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, that he would take him home. And so he dwelt among the people. And so Jeremiah, he's an old man by now. His ministry was 40 years of preaching this message to the people. He's released now from prison. He's being protected by the Babylonians, and he's allowed now to live among the people. This is grace. This is grace upon an individual in the larger context of judgment that's coming upon the nation. And meanwhile, verse 15, the word of the Lord had come to Jeremiah while he was shut up in the prison. So here's a word that God gave before he was released by Nebuchadnezzar from the prison. And God said to Jeremiah, go and speak to Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian. Do you remember him from last week? Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian. He was a foreigner in Judah, a eunuch who we saw last week courageously spoke up when the princes of Judah had thrown Jeremiah into a pit and left him there to starve to death and die. This Ethiopian eunuch, a foreigner, who was banned from worship at the temple, this Ebed-Melech, he went and pleaded with the king and said, don't let Jeremiah, he's going to die down there. Please, give a command that we can get him out of there. And the king said, go ahead, I give you 30 men. Take him and lift him out with ropes. And this Ebed-Melech, before they went, he realized Jeremiah's emaciated. He's a skinny old man. And he went and he got these old clothes and these rags and stuff, and he was so careful, he was so full of compassion, that he told Jeremiah, put all this padding under your armpit so that when we lift you out, it doesn't rip your arms up. And so God now is telling Jeremiah, I want you to go find Ebed-Melech, and I want you to speak to him and say, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring words upon this city. I will bring my words to pass upon this city for adversity and not for good. And there shall be performed in that day before me these words. But I will deliver you in that day. God's saying to you, God's going to deliver you. You will not be given into the hand of the men of whom you are afraid. For I will surely deliver you, and you shall not fall by the sword. But your life will be like a prize to you because you've put your trust in me, says the Lord. This is radical. This dude's a foreigner. He's an Ethiopian. And it's interesting because God looks at Ebed-Melech, this Ethiopian, what he did. God looks at the courage and the compassion and the care that he had for God's prophet. Am I having a stroke right now, or is there something weird with the sound? Testing, 1, 2, 3. How's that? Back in action. God looks at this Ebed-Melech, and notice here what he did, his courage, his compassion, his care for God's prophet. And we see here what God says to him is that all that you, God realizes, all that sprang out that you did, it all sprang from your trust in me. And this is how it works. Faith, we're not saved by works. We're saved by faith, but faith has works that come. If I say I believe a bomb's going to drop on this church in 15 minutes, and 14 minutes from now I'm still preaching, you'd be looking at me like he doesn't believe what he's saying. He does not believe that if I say a bomb's going to hit this building in 15 minutes, I'd be out of here in 15 seconds, and I'd be calling you all to run with me, okay? Faith, we're not saved by works, but we're saved by faith. But faith, it's faith that works, okay? And so God has this message, I love this, for Ebed-Melech. And then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord after Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, had let him go from Ramah, when he had taken him bound in chains among all that were carried away captive from Jerusalem and Judea, who were carried away captive to Babylon. So when Jerusalem fell, Jeremiah, we see here, he was gathered with all the other captives and brought to this staging area in Ramah. This is about 5 miles north of Jerusalem. And from there, the deportees, they would be sent in these groups to Babylonia. And so here we're told that Jeremiah was among that group. He was there at the staging. And the captain of the guard took Jeremiah. He found him there at being ready to be sent off. And he said to him, notice, this is the Babylonian captain of the guard. He says to Jeremiah, the Lord your God, your God, Jeremiah, has pronounced doom on this place. Now the Lord has brought it. This is the Babylonian speaking. The Lord has brought, just as you said, Jeremiah, because you people have sinned against the Lord and not obeyed his voice, therefore this thing has come upon you. So apparently, this Babylonian captain of the guard knew about Jeremiah and knew about his prophecies. And here he was repeating basically a summary of what Jeremiah had been preaching all those years. He's repeating it back to Jeremiah with a sense of amazement and wonder. He's looking at him going, everything you said has come to pass. And now look, Jeremiah, I'm freeing you. I'm freeing you this day from the chains that are on your hands. And if it seems good to you, Jeremiah, you come with me to Babylon. Come and I will look after you. But if it seems wrong for you to come with me to Babylon, then remain here. See, all the land is before you, Jeremiah. Whatever it seems good and convenient for you to go, you go there. And so this pagan captain of the guard is treating Jeremiah like a rock star, basically. He's like, dude, everything you said, he's like, You're this prophet of God. I've been hearing about what you've been saying. Whatever you want, man. You come with me, I'll take care of you. You stay here. Whatever seems good to you, you just let me know. And so this is amazing. Here's Jeremiah, man. The tables have turned for him personally, though I'm sure he's radically grieved that the people have inflicted such pain on themselves. But this Babylonian guard, he's you can just feel him. He's kind of like looking at Jeremiah like he's a sort of celebrity, you know, like, whatever you want, man, I'll make it happen for you, you know. And now, while Jeremiah had not yet gone back, so Jeremiah's in this place of decision. He has this option. I can go to Babylon, and the Babylonian government is going to plush me out. I could live first class in comfort and luxury. Or I could stay here. He's sitting there thinking, should I stay or should I go? If I stay, there will be trouble. If I go, it will be double. No, that was the Clash, right? Now, Jeremiah's thinking here. He's in the middle, verse 5. Well, Jeremiah had not yet gone back. He's still struggling with the decision. You know, should I go back and be comfortable? Should I go back with this Babylonian, being taken care of, living in luxury, or should I stay here? Remember, with the poor, because only the poorest were staying in the land to till the fields and to harvest the crops, and they would be heavily taxed by the Babylonians. And Nebuzaradan, he said, he's watching Jeremiah in this struggle, and he says, go back to Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam. Now, this Gedaliah was this governor that was appointed by Babylon to watch over all these poor people that were staying in the land to till the land and to raise the grapes and all the crops. And so Nebuzaradan, he's watching Jeremiah. He's like, he goes, dude, your heart is here. He could see it. He's like, just go back and with the governor we've appointed, this guy, the son of this other guy that the king of Babylon has made governor over the cities of Judah, dwell with him among the people, or whatever it seems convenient to you. So the captain of the guard gave him rations and a gift and let him go. This is so interesting. He's being honored and taken care of by this pagan authority, but it's really God looking after his prophet. You know, F.B. Meyer says of this passage, God is able to supply the needs of his servants in all sorts of ways. He's supplied through by ravens to Elijah. He's supplied by a widow, a poor widow, to Elisha. Here, Jeremiah is supplied by the captain of Nebuchadnezzar's guard. And F.B. Meyer says, when we're all in for God, he's all in for us. And so sensing Jeremiah really wanted to stay, Nebuzaradan here voices what he could see was Jeremiah's deepest desire, which was to stay in the land, which was to stay with the people. And so he makes this provision. He says, you go to Gedaliah, go to the governor we've appointed. And Jeremiah went. Notice verse 6. He went to Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, to Mizpah, and he dwelt with him among the people who were left in the land. He could have lived in luxury in Babylon, but he chose to stay in the land and with the poor people of Judah rather than go to Babylon. He chose the land and the people because he loved both of them. Jeremiah went where his love went, even though the option was just comfort and luxury. One commentator named Kundell says, Jeremiah wasn't vindictive, nor did he feel the slightest elation at the downfall of his adversaries, which were his own people that had persecuted him. They were his people. He loved them. He wept bitterly for them, just as the book of Lamentation shows us. And so verse 7, when all the captains of the armies who were in the fields, they and their men heard that the king of Babylon had made Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the governor, notice, and had committed to him men, women, children, and the poorest of the land who had not been carried away to Babylon. So when the Babylonians captured Judah, some of the military captains and their men who had escaped, they now appear. They come out of hiding, and these captains had to choose whether they would continue the fight as an underground resistance or submit to Babylonian rule. And so they come now to Gedaliah to see if he was going to support the Babylonians or if he was going to begin to betray Babylon and you know, who put him in power. Just like Zedekiah had betrayed Babylon, who had put him in power. There's this interesting thing happening here after the destruction of Judah. There's a power vacuum. You know, and there's people that still are trying to figure out what exactly happened. And these captains, they came to Gedaliah. Remember, Gedaliah is this governor appointed by the Babylonians to calm down the people remaining there and to get them to work so they could tax them and get tribute from them. So when these captains now, these fighters that were still there, they came to Gedaliah at Mizpah, and Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, this other guy, Johanan, and Jonathan, the sons of Kareah, Sariah, the son of this other dude, and the son of Ephi, this other kind of guy, and Jezaniah, the son of the Malachite, never mind. Okay, verse 9. And Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan. Isn't it amazing the details? These guys are just being so specific about places and who was there. You know, it's an incredible record. But Gedaliah, this governor appointed by Babylon, the son of Shaphan, he took an oath before these men. Okay, he's appointed by Babylon. Now these men of Judah that were captains, that were part of the resistance, they come out of hiding, and Gedaliah is standing there saying, don't be afraid to serve the Chaldeans. Okay, now Gedaliah is saying exactly what Jeremiah has been saying all along. This is the will of God, that we submit, because God's going to use Babylon to chasten us. And so these fighters come, and this appointed governor says, don't be afraid to submit and serve the Chaldeans. Live in the land, serve the king of Babylon, and it will be well with you. Exactly what Jeremiah had been saying all this time. And Gedaliah, this governor appointed by the Babylonians, he says, as for me, I will indeed dwell at Mizpah, and I'm going to serve the Chaldeans who come to us. But you guys, gather wine, summer fruits and oil, put them in your vessels and dwell in your cities that you have taken. Get to work. You know, plant your fields, harvest the crops. And we're going to pay our taxes to Babylon, because this is where we're at right now. This is what God wants. Okay? Likewise, when all the Jews who were in Moab, among the Ammonites, in Edom, who were in all the countries, okay? So all these people that have fled when Babylon was crushing Judah, when they heard that the king of Babylon had left a remnant in Judah, that some were remaining there, the poor, to till the land and all, that he had set over them this Gedaliah, the son of Shaphan, then all the Jews returned out of all the places where they had been driven, where they'd run to hide. And they came to the land of Judah, and they came to Gedaliah at Mizpah, and they began to gather wine and the summer fruit. They began to get to work. Moreover, Johanan, the son of Kareah, and all of the captains of the forces that were in the fields, they came to Gedaliah. And they said to him, do you certainly know? Okay, now these guys are bringing this report. Did you hear that Baalis, the king of the Ammonites, this foreign king, has sent Ishmael, the son of this other guy, to murder you? And Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, he didn't believe them. Okay, this is a picture of this war has completely destroyed everything that was before. The government has been completely replaced. Okay? And there's these power struggles. You know, there's new people in power. People are coming out of hiding from the incredible force when the Babylonians were in town. And now these guys bring this report. They bring this report and they said, do you know that there's a plot to murder you? Do you realize that? This Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, is planning to kill you. And Gedaliah is like, no, I don't believe that. You see, Ishmael was of royal lineage. He was actually of the house of David. But he was known to be a passionate member of the anti-Babylonian party. He was filled with jealousy and hatred for this Gedaliah, who is now appointed governor. In his head, he's from the line of David, and one of his people should be in charge. But here, this guy, Gedaliah, has been put there, and he's not of David's line. And so these remaining officers in the land, they bring this warning to Gedaliah, saying, this dude wants to assassinate you. But Gedaliah's like, nah, I don't believe that. Why would he do that? There's a commentator named Thompson. He said, he seems to have had a magnanimous disposition, this Gedaliah. He was unable to believe that one that he knew personally when he was a state official, a person of royal heritage, was capable of such evil. So he's like, he just blows off this warning of an assassination. And then Johanan, the son of Kareah, spoke secretly. So another guy comes, and he takes Gedaliah aside secretly, and he says, let me go, please. Please, let me go, and I will kill Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and no one will know it. Just let me go and take this one guy out. He's saying he's going to kill you. Why should he murder you so that all the Jews who are gathered to you would be scattered and the remnant, the few that are left would perish? But Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, he said to Johanan, this second messenger that brings the news that there's an assassination plot against you, he said, you will do no thing. You will not do this thing. I don't want you to go kill this guy, for you speak falsely concerning Ishmael. So this guy, he's a newly appointed governor, and he seems to be naive. You know, when many people are bringing you the same report, when many different sources are bringing you the same report, there's a saying, 1,000 flies can't be wrong. If you see 1,000 flies on something, it's caca right there. 1,000 flies can't be wrong. And yet this Gedaliah, he continues to trust what he knew of Ishmael, and he regards this as a false report. And it came to pass in the 7th month that Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, the son of this other guy of the royal family of the officers of the king, came with 10 men to Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, at Mizpah. And there they ate bread together. And then Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and the 10 men who were with him arose, and they struck Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, with the sword, and killed him, whom the king of Babylon had made governor over the land. He's sharing a meal with him. Kundal points out, since the sharing of a meal was regarded as a covenant of brotherhood in the Middle East, you share a meal with someone, and that's a sign you are family. He says the treachery, Kundal says, the treachery of his act was all the more reprehensible. Kind of reminds you of Judas. After the Last Supper, he rose up to betray Christ, and he betrayed him with a kiss. Ishmael also struck down, notice, all the Jews who were with Gedaliah. That is with Gedaliah at Mizpah, and the Chaldeans who were found there, the men of war. So this Ishmael character, with his 10 men, they murdered this appointed governor, as well as all of his men. And he did it because Baalish, the king of the Ammonites, had hired him to do it, as we saw in chapter 40, verse 14. It's so interesting that this Ishmael of the royal family, of the officers of the king, a descendant of David, he's just jealous. He feels like this is so wrong that this guy is governor of Judah. This is something that should be one of the descendants of David. In his jealousy, he pulls off this heinous act. Kidner, Derek Kidner, says everything about Ishmael disgraced the name of David, his forebearer, who had resisted every impulse. David resisted every impulse to wade through slaughter to a throne. Remember, David was tormented by Saul. Saul was out to kill David. David was on the run for 20 years, and David refused. And he had opportunity. He could take Saul out. He could have had Saul killed, and he refused. He's like, I'm not gonna put myself anywhere. God's gonna put me where he wants me, and he's gonna put me where he wants me when he wants me. Even though he was being chased and tormented by Saul. And here this Ishmael, with the zeal for the house of David, he kills this governor, thinking, long live David the king. And he totally misrepresents David. One of the main characteristics of David's life is that he would not take his life into his own hands. He would not take anybody out to put himself in. He would not put anybody down to lift himself up. This was one of the main characteristics of David. Even though it meant 20 years of running from an insane, psychopathic King Saul. And so this guy completely misrepresents. He's no David. He's no David at all. It's interesting, in the centuries that followed, the Jews observed a fast to commemorate this tragedy here, where this, what's his name again? Ishmael killed Gedaliah. And you can see that where that fast was called in Zechariah chapter 7, verse 5. And it happened on the second day after he had killed Gedaliah, when as yet nobody knew about it. So 2 days had gone by and the word hadn't got out, that certain men from Shechem, Shiloh, and Samaria, 80 men with their beards shaved and their clothes torn, having cut themselves with offerings and incense in their hand, they brought them to the house of the Lord. So this is kind of a different topic here, but they're saying 2 days after Gedaliah was killed, these men show up from the north. These are northern cities. And they come, and these are worshipers of Yahweh. The temple's destroyed, but these are coming with these sacrifices and offerings. They're coming with their beards shaved and with signs of deep sorrow because Jerusalem's been ransacked. And yet they're coming to the chosen city with their sacrifice. Feinberg says, in spite of the destruction of the temple itself, they came to the temple site, which was still used for worship by those who survived the fall of the city. Even the ruins were held to be sacred, just as the western wall of the temple in Jerusalem is held to be sacred to this day. So here these guys show up, and now Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, went out from Mizpah to meet these worshipers that are coming with the signs of mourning, their beards shaved and all. And he met them as they were weeping. Ishmael the son went out to meet them, weeping as he went along. And it happened as he met them that he said to them, come to Gedaliah. Okay, he just killed Gedaliah. He says, come to the governor. And so it was when they came into the midst of the city, Ishmael the son of Nethaniah killed them. This guy's just a full, out of control murderer. But I think of some of the people in the Ukraine right now. You know, any area where a war breaks out. I lived in Serbia when the war broke out there, when Yugoslavia broke into pieces. I was there for a year. And the atrocities of war, what it can do to people. You know, people can get tweaked for life. This dude is tweaked. Ishmael's tweaked. He invites these guys into an ambush. These guys that had come to worship the Lord. And he killed them and he cast them into the middle of a pit. He and the men who were with him, but the 10 men were found. There were 10 men among these 80 that had come who said to Ishmael, don't kill us. We've got treasures. We've got supplies that we'll give you. We'll trade you our supplies of wheat and barley and oil and honey. And so Ishmael desisted. He didn't kill them. He's like, all right, you want to bribe me to stay alive? And he did. And now the pit into which Ishmael had cast all the dead bodies of the men whom he had slain because of Gedaliah, this pit was the same one Asa the king had made for fear of Baasha the king of Israel. Okay, this is all incredibly detailed recordings of what had gone on. Ishmael the son of Nethaniah filled it with the slain. He filled this cistern up with these dead bodies. And then Ishmael carried away captive all the rest of the people who were in Mizpah, the king's daughters, the people who remained in Mizpah, whom Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, had committed to Gedaliah. And Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, carried them captive, and he departed to go over to the Ammonites. So he's taken all these captives, these beautiful young girls, these slaves, these people. He's taken them, and he's going to sell them as slaves to this foreign king, the Ammonites. F.B. Meyer says, this chapter is full of the horrible atrocities of war. Blow upon blow, Meyer says, befell the already decimated remnant of the Jews. But when these names are just killing me, guys. But when Johanan, the son of Korea, and all the captains of the forces that were with him heard of all the evil that Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, had done, they took all the men and went to fight with Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and they found him by the great pool that's in Gibeon. So these guys heroically rise up. Johanan goes and says, we got to go stop this guy. And so it was when all the people who were with Ishmael saw Johanan, the son of Korea, all these people that he had taken captive, that he was going to take and sell off and to the king of the Ammonites, when all these people saw Johanan show up, they were glad. And all the people whom Ishmael had carried away captive from Mizpah, they turned around and they came back and they went to Johanan, the son of Korea. So they were so happy to see him. Apparently, both Ishmael's captives and the captains were happy to see him. And so they run over to him. But Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, escaped from Johanan with 8 men and went. And then he took off to the Ammonites. So he escaped out of the land. And Johanan, the son of Korea, and all the captains of the forces that were with him took from Mizpah all the rest of the people whom he had recovered from Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, after he had murdered Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam. My gosh, every time they mention these guys, they tell who their dad was. Can you imagine if every time you saw someone, you're like, hey, Mike Morley, the son of Joe, you know. Anyway, the mighty men of war and the women and the children, the eunuchs whom he brought back from Gibeon, and they departed and dwelt in the habitation of Chimham, which is near Bethlehem, if you wanted to know exactly where they stayed. As they were on their way to Egypt because of the Chaldeans, for they were afraid of them because Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, had murdered Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, just in case you were wondering which Gedaliah we're talking about, whom the king of Babylon had made governor of the land. Look at that. I'm ready to pass out, man. Anyway, there was a lot going on here when Jerusalem fell, if you want to sum it up. When war is going on, things get crazy. You know, power vacuums, jealousies, egos. I mean, the parallels are too many to draw right now. If you imagine what's happening in the Ukraine, you know, we're seeing some of it on YouTube. You go on there and you see these captured soldiers. This has never happened in the history of the world, where we're being live streamed a war and what's going on behind the scenes. It's pretty insane. But somehow the Lord reigns over all of our human chaos. We need to be in prayer. I'm convinced God's calling his church right now to prayer. Because prayer can change things. You know, the prayer that Jesus gave us, if you haven't been here on Sunday recently, we just looked at the Lord's Prayer. When you pray, pray after this manner: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Here it is. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Because right now the kingdoms of men are showing themselves to be so insane, like they've always been. And the prayer of the church is not, Lord, bless this political party or that one and get us fighting each other, but Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, in us. Here's in us and through us, Lord, as it is in heaven. God's will is, it's not being done right now on earth. The kingdom of heaven has been planted in the first coming of Christ. It's been inaugurated, you might say. When he comes again, it will be culminated in its fullness. Right now, we're the people of God, and this is our cry. God, your will be done. Your kingdom come. Bring it down, Lord. Bring it down in us. Bring it into us. Bring it through us. You know, give us this day. Give us day by day our daily bread. Give us everything we need to face one day at a time. What are you going through today? You know, what are you going through? Give us day by day. He'll strengthen you day by day. Whatever it is. The sorrow that you might face today, the sudden loss of a loved one. You know, what fear do you have? Oh my gosh, is this World War III? Maybe it is. God's with us today. You know, maybe the world will blow up tomorrow and we'll all be in heaven with Jesus. Is that bad? No, that's not bad. But one day at a time, give us day by day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. I'm so full of sin, God. Forgive me day by day and help me let go of the people that offend me. Anybody ever get offended? Anybody ever go a whole day without being offended in some way by somebody? Okay, if you aren't, you're not on the freeways, that's for sure. Okay, if you're not offended at least a little bit every day, you're not married. You know, you're a hermit somewhere and you're in a closet somewhere. Day by day, Lord, we forgive those that have offended us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And let me say this, there's evil outside of us. We don't need to run through the list. This whole thing shows us how evil it can get. But there's evil inside of me. Deliver me from the evil potential I have inside of me to wreck my life, to ruin my wife, to destroy my kids, to lose my ministry. This is our prayer. This is where we should live in prayer. Day by day, praying the prayer Jesus gave us to pray. And so, Father, hear us. And we thank you that you do hear us. And we do lift up, Lord, this world to you. We do pray right now for your spirit to fall on Vladimir Putin. Lord, whatever's driving the guy, Lord, there's people dying, people hurt, getting hurt. We pray for the Russian people, Lord, the hundreds of thousands of them that hate what's happening. Lord, we pray for these young men that didn't even know they were going into a battle. They're on these videos saying, we thought we were doing a drill. And they're crying, little boys, 16-year-olds, 17-year-old boys that don't even want to be there. They don't want to shoot these Ukrainians. They almost speak the same language. They look like us. And Lord, we're not looking at the Ukrainians like they're a bunch of saints or angels. Lord, it's a very corrupt country with one of the most vicious mafias in the world. But we're praying, God, for mercy. We pray for all the mothers and the children that are trying to get their babies out of harm's way. We thank you for the Hungarians that are meeting them at the border. We praise you for all the help, the people that are just trying to help. But we pray, God, that your will would be done, your kingdom would come. We pray for President Biden, Lord, and our Congress and Senate and all these politicians, Lord. We're so mad at some of them, we're disgusted with others, Lord, but we pray for these guys. Lord, we pray that you would give them wisdom, help them get out, all of them, on both sides, to get out of their ego, to forget about their own interests, to make wise decisions. Lord, we cry out to you, Lord, our Father who's in heaven. We cry out to you, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done. We pray that you'd bring what the enemy means for evil, you would turn it around for good. That you'd bring hundreds of thousands and millions of people to Christ. As people look around and go, wow, man is messed up. Mankind is in need of salvation. We cry out, Lord, for your church, that we could be the church right now. And that you would bring millions of people. There'd be a revival, Lord. A worldwide revival of people realizing, man, he who trusts in man is in trouble. Blessed is he whose hope is in the Lord. So God, we commit all these things to you, and we pray that you'd bless. We lift up Pastor Ed, Lord, as he's at home wishing he was here. As you just help him, Lord. It must be frustrating that you'd heal him up. Provide everything he needs. We commit, be with us as we all go now and lay down on our beds and get up in the morning and live one day at a time, day by day, trusting in you. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody who agreed said out loud together, amen. Amen. Blessings on you. We'll see you next time. Three chapters. Whoa.
Walking the wayside, lost on a lonely road. I was chasing a high life, trying to satisfy my soul. All the lies I believed in left me.